This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
The Turkish army threatened to intervene to prevent the presidential candidate of the Justice and Development Party, Abdullah Gül, from reaching the presidency office, a position that does not enjoy significant executive authorities. Thousands of Turks went to the streets to express their commitment to the principles of secularism that were established by Mustafa Kemal Atatürk and their opposition to Gül's presidential candidacy due to his Islamist inclinations.
For the second time in 1 month, Turkey witnesses massive demonstrations against the Justice and Development Party's presidential candidate. The first demonstration took place in Ankara, but this one was held in the largest Turkish city of Istanbul. According to local Turkish television stations, hundreds of thousands of Turks gathered in the Şaglıyan area to express their support of secularism and the rejection of current Foreign Minister Abdullah Gül's presidential candidacy.
These people came here to defend the Turkish Republic. Atatürk, who established this republic, is still alive inside of us. Those who are threatening our democracy must be ashamed of themselves. They must hear our voices and understand our slogans.
This demonstration, which was covered with red Turkish flags, was called for by approximately 600 non-governmental organizations and opposition parties. They massed people from all over Turkey during the weekend to maximize the number of protesters.
We, the free women of Turkey, do not want hijab. We want to be like the European females, but we do not want to join the European Union. We want Turkey to stay free and independent.
Seeing these masses is pleasing to everyone. Turkey will not be endangered as long as these masses are present.
People were yelling slogans against the Justice and Development Party and its presidential candidate Abdullah Gül, as well as the Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan. They called on the government to resign and chanted, "All of us are Atatürk's soldiers, Turkey is secular and it will stay secular." The only presidential candidate, Abdullah Gül, declared that he would not withdraw his candidacy despite the strong worded threat made by the Turkish army, which accused the Justice and Development ruling party of threatening the country's secularism. In a surprise move, the Turkish Association of Industrialists called for early parliamentary elections to protect democracy and secularism in the country. Is Turkey on the verge of a new political and economical crisis? Well, these massive demonstrations against the presidential candidacy of Abdullah Gül, who has Islamic orientations, have an impact on the Constitutional Court's decision on the appeal case. Recent developments indicate that Turkey is on the verge of a real crisis.
Istanbul.
The process is going on. The withdrawal of my candidacy is not an option. This decision has been made after long discussions, after exchanging views. It was not taken in one night. The process is going on. Altogether, we have to wait for the Constitutional Court's decision. I think it is not correct to comment on that issue. The court will evaluate the issue and will decide in a most appropriate way.
Iraq's casualty toll is assessed once each month. The growing violence in Iraq continues to overshadow the country's security and political situations. The month of April, which marks the fourth anniversary of the U.S.-led occupation in Iraq, was the worst for the British forces there. During the month of April, 12 British and 103 U.S. soldiers were killed in Iraq. This news seems to further undermine the White House policy in Iraq. Esmahan Khoury reports.
مع كل محطة زمنية تقف الخسائر لتعلن عن نفسها، ومع نهاية كل شهر تبرز.
Iraq's casualty toll is assessed at the end of each month. The monthly death toll among U.S. forces in Iraq seems to reflect on the American public opinion. The monthly death toll of U.S. forces in Iraq is reflected in American public opinion polls. Many Americans now, more than ever, are asking the big question: why and until when? The U.S. military announced that 4 of its soldiers were killed in the past 2 days. During the month of April, more than 100 U.S. soldiers have been killed in Iraq, thus making it one of the bloodiest months since the 2003 U.S.-led occupation in the country. With more than 137 soldiers killed, November 2004 is still the bloodiest month for the U.S. forces in Iraq. And the second bloodiest month for the U.S. troops was April 2004, with 135 soldiers killed. The current total death toll among U.S. soldiers in Iraq stands at 3,330. In comparison, the luck of America's closest ally in the war on terror was not any better. The British Defense Ministry announced that a British soldier was killed in clashes in Basra. The death toll among British forces since the U.S.-led war on Iraq stands at 146. More than 12 British soldiers were killed during the month of April, which makes it the bloodiest month for the British forces in Iraq. Meanwhile, a booby-trapped car exploded in a busy neighborhood in Basra, killing 6 residents and injuring several others. The British forces are in charge of security in Basra in southern Iraq, a relatively calm region. These incidents and many others in Iraq continue to overshadow the political life in the U.S. and England. However, the Iraqi people are the real victims in a massacre that was orchestrated against them in their own homeland.
العراقيين هم الوقود الحقيقي للمجزرة الدائرة بحقهم وعلى أرضهم.
نظم المواطنون المهجرون من محافظة ديالى اعتصاما.
The displaced citizens from the district of Diyala organized a demonstration in the blessed town of Karbala, demanding the eradication of terrorist cells in the district. They confirmed that the inhabitants of the district are ready to support the security forces to achieve this goal.
Women, children, and seniors gathered in the district of Karaba to send their message and move the conscience of Muslims concerning the district of Diyala. They demanded that the Iraqi government stop the cycle of death and obstruct the terrorists that have spread their mayhem in Diyala.
The main reason for the protest is to ask the government, parliament, and Iraqi and international organizations to highlight the suffering of the inhabitants of Diyala from terrorism.
The governor, along with the security officials in the district, state that the situation is peaceful. There are 500 meters between the district and the administration building. 5 men were killed in this area, only 150 meters away from the administration.
The terrorists in Diyala only speak the language of killing, beheading, and forceful migration. Protesters confirm that the local government in Diyala has not provided anything to the city or to its inhabitants. They demanded that the government, which stays behind the protected walls, be changed.
We demand that the parliament members form an inquiry committee to investigate what's happening in the district. We have social demands. We also demand that the victims of terrorism be compensated in a way that takes into consideration the level of their suffering.
Some of the afflicted mothers who lost their sons were left without any providers. Also, the orphans are waiting to return to their schools and their playgrounds.
They cut off his head. The next day at 6 a.m., I found his head. We could not find his body. The next day, they threatened us, saying that we have to leave our home.
We, the families of martyrs, are demanding compensation so we can return to our areas. How can we return to our area if there is no security?
Protesters vowed to work together together with the government to rid their district from terrorists and Takfiri groups and expel them from Iraq. Iraqis are making legitimate demands, but such demands are now considered wishful thinking and dreams. Diyala's residents' dream to go back to their homes seems hard to attain. They are only asking to return to their city. Is that too much to ask?
Thousands of Afghans protested in the east after six people were killed during a raid by U.S.-led coalition forces and five others detained. Angry demonstrators carried the bodies of the dead along a main road near the provincial capital, Jalalabad, blocking it with tree trunks and branches. They refused to unblock the route or bury the dead until those taken into custody by the U.S. military were released. Mangarhar police spokesman said the dead were all civilians, including three women, and the U.S. military said four of those killed were Taliban fighters, and a woman and a teenage girl died in crossfire. Several hundred civilians have died in fighting this year, most due to attacks by the Taliban, including suicide bombings, but a significant number is also due to action by foreign forces. Somalian government sent troops to the streets to show they are in control of the city and that they had taken over from the insurgents. Allied Somali-Ethiopian troops patrolled Mogadishu, hunting for weapons after claiming significant gains in battles with insurgents that have killed at least 1,300 people since February. Interim government forces were deployed in the city's Bakara market, a former stronghold of rebels, frustrating the administration's efforts to restore central rule in the Horn of African nation for the first time in 16 years. Some residents are happy that calm has returned and are willing to take their families back to the city with the hope that the government will protect them. Government troops were posted at strategic junctions in the city, searching cars and passengers for arms. The United Nations has accused both sides in the conflict of breaking humanitarian law by indiscriminately firing on civilian areas and said the rate of displacement in Somalia over the past 3 months has been worse than Iraq in the same period.
The Taliban movement is making efforts to portray a good image of itself in the areas where it has control. Members of the Taliban try not to intervene in the daily lives of citizens with the hope to gain their support in the war against the foreign and Afghan forces. The Taliban has also established a Shura Council to represent the tribes, in addition to another appointed council which acts as a judicial and a penal system in the areas under its control.
The residents of the Taliban-controlled Afghan areas do not hide their surprise over the Taliban's drastic change in how it deals with the people, a change from the days when it had complete power. The Taliban is trying to present a good image of the movement, especially in the markets.
The members of the Taliban treat us well. They don't interfere with our business. They return security and have good feelings toward us in this region. There are no roadblocks, thieves, or any bad people, thank God. All this because of the presence of the Taliban.
The only medical clinic in the area of Hazara Jift continues to function the same way, both before and after the movement took control. A male doctor and female doctor work in two separate rooms.
The members of the Taliban respect us a lot. They protect and look after us. Sometimes I do not return to my home for an entire month. However, nobody dares to raid my house in my absence. I don't have any problems with them.
Satisfaction with the Taliban movement's power stems from its establishing two Shura councils. The first council is appointed by the Taliban to administrate in the region. The second council is chosen by tribes that represent all the segments of society, including Shiite Muslims and ethnic Uzbeks.
We're always in contact with the people. As long as they call on us, we try to resolve all their problems, even if they occur late at night. The people can contact us without any obstacles.
To strengthen the power and respect of the Taliban administration, the movement's local regime has refused to give prison sentences to cases which are still being disputed. Meanwhile, others whose criminal charges have been proven are awaiting prison sentences. As long as life is simple, it continues to go on, whether or not a government is present. It has remained as such for many centuries.
At 4 o'clock this afternoon, Prime Minister Ehud Olmert and Defence Minister Amir Peretz were handed the complete copies of the Winograd Interim Report on last summer's Lebanon War, the report that could seal their political future. And exactly 1.5 hours ago, retired Judge Dr. Eliyahu Winograd and his commission faced the press at the Jerusalem Convention Center and read out the declassified sections of the committee's report on the first 5 days of the war and the years leading up to it. Professor Ruth Gavison, a member of the commission, had this statement.
We determine that there are very serious failings in these decisions and the way they were made. We impose the primary responsibility for these failures on the Prime Minister, the Minister of Defense, and the outgoing Chief of Staff. All three made a decisive personal contribution to these decisions and the way in which they were made. However, there are many others who share responsibility for the mistakes we found in these decisions and for their background conditions. The IDF was not ready for this war. Among the many reasons for this, we can mention a few. Some of the political and military elites in Israel have reached the conclusion that Israel is beyond the era of wars. It had enough military might and superiority to deter others from declaring war against her. These would also be sufficient to send a painful reminder to anyone who seemed to be undeterred. Since Israel did not intend to initiate a war, the conclusion was that the main challenge facing the land forces would be low-intensity asymmetrical conflicts.
And these are the conclusions of the Winograd report concerning the Prime Minister and the Defence Minister. The Commission finds that the most serious failing was that of the person who stands at the head of the political pyramid, Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. The criticism of Olmert is more scathing than that was leaked to the press over the last couple of days. Olmert is found to be guilty of a grave failure of judgment, lack of responsibility, and rashness in going to war. According to the report, Olmert made the decision to go to war last July 12th hastily, without a comprehensive plan, without taking into account the almost certain Katyusha onslaught on the north that would result, and without considering the alternatives, including diplomatic action, that might have been more effective. The Cabinet says the Winograd Commission voted to go to war without fully understanding the military plans for fighting that war or the state of the armed forces. As for Defence Minister Amir Peretz, the Commission found that even though Peretz was almost entirely ignorant in military and strategic affairs and the use of force to achieve diplomatic goals, he failed to consult with experienced defence experts. His influence on the conduct of the war was minimal. He did not ask the Chief of Staff for detailed plans or examine how effective the Army's plans were in meeting the goals of the government. Peretz's inexperience made it impossible for him to challenge the army that he was supposed to supervise, and his poor functioning weakened the government's ability to face its enemies.
The Winograd Commission had harsh criticism of the army's conduct of the war. Former Chief of Staff Dan Chalutz, who stepped down in the wake of the war and is now doing a year of study at Harvard University, must have flinched today when he heard the report. According to the commission, Lieutenant General Chalutz was guilty of poor judgment, lack of professionalism, and overweening confidence. In its scathing report, the committee charged that Chalutz failed to reveal to the Prime Minister and the Defense Minister, whom he knew to be almost entirely ignorant of military knowledge, the true state of the Army and its depleted supplies. The commission said Chalutz was responsible for not being prepared for the escalation along the Lebanese border and for not having a workable strategic plan the day the war broke out, which could have helped government officials see the situation more clearly and perhaps offer alternatives. How did we arrive at today's published report by the Winograd Commission? What happened last summer that forced Prime Minister Ehud Olmert to appoint this panel of inquiry? IBA's Ellie Wagelernter takes a look.
The Winograd Commission report was the inevitable result of the Second Lebanon War after the vast majority of Israelis concluded that the Israeli government and the military failed in its mission. That indeed was part of the mandate of the commission, to investigate the actions and inactions of Prime Ministers Ehud Barak and Ariel Sharon from the time Israel pulled out of Lebanon in May 2000 until the beginning of the Second Lebanon War. What were the political reasons why nothing was done for 6 years while Hezbollah continued its arms buildup? And how did that impact the ultimate decision to go to war?
The committee is trying to find out if the decision that was taken in those days realized that they are talking about a war and not about something else.
Among the shortcomings revealed in the media in the wake of the war were the military issues, the tactical and strategic decisions made by Defense Minister Amir Peretz and Chief of Staff Dan Chalutz, the lack of clear military goals, the collapse of the home front, and the million civilians who were holed up in shelters or who had to evacuate their homes to avoid the falling Katyushas. 119 soldiers were killed in the war, and 41 civilians died as a result of the barrage of rockets.
They went to war without being prepared enough, without checking that IDF was prepared enough to go to this war. I think this is the main conclusion of this war, which put the flash on the decision-making process of the Prime Minister, the Defense Minister, and their cabinet.
Most of the events of the war itself were not discussed in today's interim report. Those details will be issued in the complete report scheduled for release in August. Whether Prime Minister Olmert can politically withstand the findings of the full report will be the question everyone will be asking for the next 4 months. Ellie Wagelernter, IBA News.
And now we welcome to our studio two people who know more than most others about the connection between war, politics, and media strategy. Nachman Shai, former chief army spokesman and currently Israeli director of the UJC, and Hirsch Goodman, former military correspondent and Jerusalem Report editor and currently head of the information strategy program at Tel Aviv University. Thank you both, gentlemen, for being here. And how shocked were you by the report? Let's
very,
start with you.
Very.
Nachman. Very.
What about you?
Yeah, no, I thought it was a very, very scathing report, way beyond. There were leaks that were accurate from Friday night on, but the tone and the language and the body language of Vinograd, it's devastating.
No doubt that Vinograd actually performed much better than anyone expected. He delivered the goods. He was appointed by Olmert and Peretz, but he did not serve them in his
Absolutely.
Interim report, and that it will go on. It just gave 4 months for the government to heal those wounds and to take care of those various failures. And he will come back to them with this panel, and it will get worse if they would not work according to his or their guidelines.
Nachman Shai, a couple of months ago, you told me on one of our broadcasts that Lieutenant General Dan Chalutz would not be the only one to lose his job over this. You still feel even more strongly?
Well, now we know. It's Peretz, and it may be Olmert. But let me be honest with you. Even if Olmert resigns now, it wouldn't change the fundamental failures that were discussed and disclosed by this committee. It goes much, much deeper, and it will be a total mistake for us Israelis to judge the entire war by the fact that Olmert is there or is not there. It goes down there, and we both served as military correspondent during the Yom Kippur War, and for me, it's the second Yom Kippur War.
Well, I would say it would make a very big difference if he had to resign or not resign. His strategy right now, as I heard from the Cabinet Secretary, is the Prime Minister will not resign. His job is to implement this very serious report. If there are elections now, it would be tohu vavohu, and there would be
chaos.
Nothing done for chaos for 6 months. Nothing would get done, and it's counter to what the report wants.
The announcement of loans for cosmetic surgery hit the streets of Beirut by storm, dividing Lebanese women between opposing and interested. A special report by colleague Deren Dabous.
دين لا تتزين، شعار أوحى إلى أحد مصاريفنا اللبنانية بابتكار قرض جديد. لا لشراء مسكن أو سيارة.
Get a loan to adorn yourself? This slogan encouraged a Lebanese bank to create a new kind of loan. Not for education, buying a home or a car, but for enlarging the lips, changing the nose, or thinning the buttocks. Reducing, enlarging, and sucking away. Each person can choose according to their needs, and this way, we all become beautiful. One ad on the street encourages getting into debt for the sake of beauty. Why don't we get into debt while our aims are the lips of Haifa Wahbi, the nose of Nancy Ajram, and the cheekbones of Elisa? Cosmetic surgery is expensive and insurance companies do not cover its costs. But the bank offering the loan found women's weak points and provided them with temptation.
The buzz around this loan surpassed our expectations. We get a minimum of 200 calls a day, and the numbers of applicants are pretty big.
The people who are calling, are they females or males?
68% of the calls are from women, while 32% are men. The requirement for getting loan approval is a monthly income of $600 for a single person and $900 for the married person. We do not ask for a security deposit, but the loan term lasts 24 months, with the total amount reaching $5,000.
As for the cosmetic surgeons' pockets, they are becoming fat with the money of those who seek beauty.
Women have started coming in and asking for information on what they need to apply for a loan. The most common operations are facelifts, beautifying the nose, lips, breasts, everything, all the cosmetic operations.
And like everything else in Lebanon, the cosmetic surgery loan has become a point of debate between the Lebanese.
It's not right. If a person has money to pay, it's okay. But to take a loan for it, it's not right. Taking a loan for housing, to buy a house, okay. But for cosmetics, no.
Would you take out a loan to get cosmetic surgery?
Why not?
What would you like to change about yourself?
Many things.
You're not satisfied with yourself as you are?
Of course I am satisfied, but if I get that chance to change, I would not say no.
Fatigue and heartache are the lot of those who are not made good looking by their creator.
The loan is good. It is for males, too.
It's for everyone.
Yeah, it's good. This is only an attempt to make money. It's all the same thing, cosmetics or otherwise.
People change their mood with cosmetic surgery.
I would plant a new hair. Why not?
Do you think about it?
No, never.
I do not like cosmetic surgery in general. Everyone is starting to look the same.
It's a good idea for artists and stylish women in the super deluxe society.
Would you consider it?
No, I do not need anything.
You're satisfied with yourself?
Yes.
Go ask a woman younger than me. What would I do with it? Our days are nearing their end, sweetheart.
I would stay a natural.
Why?
Because God created me in this way, and I do not like to change my appearance.
God is beautiful and loves beauty, but will these financial arrangements increase us in beauty? Or will they actually increase our wrinkles when we delay in repaying our loans? And will they confiscate our noses if we do not pay? Financial loans have spread to all districts and cover all needs, and no longer are limited to necessities. Now, they include cosmetic surgery. As for our internal political crisis, we've not figured out any loans or cosmetic surgery to fix the scars of Lebanon or to return light and joy to the faces of its people.
The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. Please visit linktv.org/mosaic for more information about these broadcasters, or to view previous Mosaic programs, obtain program transcripts, or receive the weekly Mosaic Intelligence Report. Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. Additional support is provided by the Firedoll Foundation, the Otto Haas Charitable Trust, and by committed Link TV viewers like you. If you value this program, please send your tax-deductible contribution to Link TV, either through the website or the mailing address listed on your screen. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only.